Now that we've got a couple of pages built and we're linking between them successfully, it's time to have a look at how to get some more dynamic data into the content of those pages. And what I mean by dynamic data is stuff that we haven't specifically typed out ourselves. This is all essentially flat HTML. There's nothing dynamic about it. So what we want to look at now is how to get variables from PHP into your templates. Let's head over to the note controller and we'll work on, what are we, let's go to the test page and we'll get some variables that spat out here. Now, as we know, that template and this route refers to this action in the controller. So let's get some data that we want to work with. Let's have a string equals, what should we say? Hello, that would be adventurous. And let's have a number equals 1 point through, that'll do. And let's try what else can we have? Oh, let's have an array, shall we? Okay, we've got some variables there, and we're going to do something with them on our example page, but we need a way to get those variables onto the page. Right now, the page has no access to those variables. And the way to do that is to use what's called the view parameters. And it's actually passed as the third argument to the view method here. And you can see that the first argument here is view class, and second one is template name, and then we've got an array of params. Now, in Zenfora, we have this convention that we call them view params, and we create an array here called view params. And now we're going to give it some named parameters. Now, generally speaking, it's a good idea to keep the names of your parameters the same as the variables that they were when you first set them up. But that's just a convention. It's not something you absolutely have to do. But for now, let's do that. So we'll have one called string, and that is going to be equal to the value of the string variable. And then we're going to have one called number, and that will be equal to, funnily enough, the number. And then we've got money equal to money. And finally, the array, which will be equal to the value of the array. And then finally, we just pass that as the third parameter, and that's good to go. Now, if we head over to the template again and just hit refresh, nothing will happen at all because we're not referencing those variables within the template. So let's go and fix that now. We'll start off in here, and we'll use, let's just split that over to the side a bit so that we can see both at the same time. Let's get that string and we'll put it in here. So we're just going to say inside a single pair of curly brackets, string. Now what that will do is it will bring into the template the value of the parameter called string. Let's double check that it does. Hello, here is some content. And if we updated that to hello comma, then I'd expect this to update as well. Great. Now, let's do something with the number. The number is number. The number is 1.2.34. That's great. We're going to do a little bit more with that in a moment. And then we're going to have a look at this money variable. Let's see, something like I have money. And at the moment, it's just going to say 10.1. But what we can do here is we can start to use variable filtering. This is a system that's built into the Zenfora template syntax, and it allows us to work on the variables within the template. So rather than having to do any kind of formatting code in your PHP, which is always the wrong place to do it, we can keep all of our formatting code in the template itself. So let's take a look at that. So I'm going to change my number to something much, much bigger. Let's change it to actually 11,234. And then I'm going to come into the template and add a pipe, and I'm going to pipe it to the number filter. What that will do is it will pass it through whatever the number filter is defined as in 10.4.0 right now. And I happen to know that it's set to use the PHP number format function with US English parameters. So it's going to add essentially 1,000 separators in there. Now, if you were working with continental European numbers, then you can go into your options and change that accordingly, depending on who your audience is. And of course, they can opt into a particular language if they want to do that as well. But there we are. There's 11,234 with an English-style 1,000 separator, all being handled by the template. We do not have to work with that in the template. In the PHP. Now, we've got this money equals 10.1. Well, no one ever says we've got 10.1 currency whatevers. We would always express it in a different way. So let's use the currency filter here. And so we have, I have money, and we'll pipe it to currency. And currency actually takes an argument. It acts a bit like a function. And let's say it's going to take the USD, US dollars, as a currency argument, and when we refresh it this time, we should see a dollar sign, and we'll get that 0.1 padded out to .10. So that's just a few examples of filtering. And then the last variable we want to look at in this little example is this array. Now we can access the elements of that array directly. Let's put them on here. I have an array, and the third element is, now remember that an array that is set up like this is keyed with 0, 1, 2, so the third element will be element 2. When you're pointing to array elements in Zen4o, we separate them with a dot character. So it would be $array.2, and that will point to the third element in the array. So we should see whatever I said with 3 as the argument. There we go. That's all fine. Now, how about looping through those? Well, looping uses a Zen4o template syntax called for each, which is very much like the PHP version of for each. So let's just refresh our memory on what for each looks like. It would be something like for each dollar array as, let's call it key and value, if I can type that, and then we'd do something with those variables in there. That's how the PHP version works. Well, the Zen4o template syntax version works very similarly. So we would do something like, let's be a bit more adventurous with our tags here. Let's have an OL, and then we'll do an XF for each. And you can see that my little autocomplete thing has brought up the complete syntax for this. So we'll start off with the loop item, which would be the first argument to this for each statement here. And at this point, I'm going to be using for each array because that's the name of the parameter I passed. And then I'm just going to call it key and value for the sake of seeing the same thing in the PHP and in the template syntax. And then in here, I can just say li value. Let's try that. And then we'll come back to other stuff in a moment. Refresh that, and we should see an ordered list with the three items in the array. Obviously, there's no reason why you can't do much more complicated stuff inside that for each loop, but for the sake of demonstration, then this is all we're going to do. Let's build another array, like, for example, let's call it A2 equals name, Mr. User, and email example at example.com, And this time we're going to pass that in here as A2. So now we've got access to that in here. Let's put in a horizontal rule and then an OL. And this time I'm going to do an XF for each again, but this time it's going to be on A2. And let's use key and value again, just for the sake of clarity. And this time we're going to have an LI, and I'm going to refer to the key this time because the key is this piece of, not that one, it's the name and the email. So now we would have something like this. The key is, let's be fancy and put this in a bold tag, value, and let's be really adventurous and wrap that in an I tag, shall we? Let's see how we do. So what I'm expecting to see here is the italic name is bold Mr. User, and the italic email is bold example at example. Let's take a look. And there we go. So that's mixing some straight HTML with template syntax there to get those variables out onto the page. Now, in addition to the parameters that we pass to the templates with our view params array here, there are also a collection of parameters or variables that are passed to templates all the time, by default, by the Zen4o system. Several of those are included in a single parameter slash variable called XF. We can go and take a look at some of the bits and pieces that are included within that, because some of them are really useful. So let's come over here and say that we want a P tag, and I'm going to allow us to see the current date and time, which obviously is not all that useful, but this is a demo really of something that I'm leading up to. So the current date and time is, and now I'm going to use xf.time. So it's an array called xf, and it has a key called time. So this will print that out when I come back to the template and refresh. Not awfully useful because that's a Unix timestamp, and you've got to be very special to understand what that means in terms of a human readable date. But never fear, we can turn that into a human readable date using another curly brace syntax function like we use for notes up here, for the link up here, and we're going to use date time. Let's open up some curly braces and call date time on xf.time. Note that while I'm calling a function with a variable, we do not need to surround it with those curly braces. It's similar to the way that PHP itself sometimes requires curly braces for variables. If in doubt, include them. It'll never hurt. But in some cases, they are not necessary. So anyway, what this is going to now give me is a human readable date and time that you don't have to be some sort of ridiculous ninja to understand. There it is. And that is formatted according to the preferences that you have set for each language. So if you have someone browsing in French language, then it will format the date according to the parameters for the language that you've set up there. Now, let's move on and see what else is in XF. And rather than sitting here and guessing about it, we can use a really, really useful function that is also part of curly brace syntax called dump. So I can open up my curly braces here, and I'm just going to dump the whole of XF. Let's take a look at what we get in here. Dump will open up this great big block of code, and you can see that there's a lot of stuff in the XF array here. 36 entries, in fact, and some of those are arrays in their own right, or even objects. So we have time that we were using just now, which is around here somewhere. We have the complete array of options that Zen4o is exposing to every page, and we can access those just by using the key for them. We have information about the style, information about the language, and information about the current visitor. So using this, we can find out whether or not the user is currently logged in. Let's take a quick look at detecting a logged in user here. And we're going to do that by, let's just check which what we're actually going to be checking here. We'll go into the visitor here and see that in the values for the visitor, we have user ID. And if the user is not logged in, their user ID is going to be zero. So we can check on that. So let's come in here and get rid of that dump for a minute. And we're going to use a construction called XFIF, which works very similarly to the standard if-else construction within PHP itself, and it looks like this. If is equals, and now we put our conditional in here, so if xf.visitor.userid, and we're just going to use this as a truthy check, if we have a user ID, then we are logged in. And we could even use the user's name, xf.visitor.username. Otherwise, let's use an xf else here. You are our guest. Let's take a look at that. So what we can see here is we've got an if tag finished off with a slash if, and then we've got a self-closing else tag, and anything that goes between the self-closing else and the closing if will be treated as the else case. We do also have an else if, but we'll deal with that another time because that's not very useful right now. So we'll come in here, and I am logged in. You can see that my username is appearing up at the top here, and it knows that I'm logged in, and so it tells me that I am. But for the sake of argument, let's log out and head over to the test page again, and you are our guest. So there we are. We've got a look at how to get templates onto, variables into your templates, how to loop through structural variables, and how to check variables. Let's move on to the next step.